So I said, "Well, I've got a few books that have pictures of them on the cover," and I showed him those. And of course, all the portraits look different, and each painter had his own way of doing things. And so when you started looking at them, I could see that would be a very tough job to figure out what he really looked like. And so then I decided, well, what I should probably do is go find all the life portraits, the ones that were done while he was alive. So this started me on a trip to try to find all the life portraits of Thomas Paine. Ended up going to the National Portrait Gallery in Washington and going through their records and finding and talking to some of the people from the Thomas Paine National Historical Association, and a fellow named David Henley, who was very helpful to me, helped steer me around to some of these things. And so I was able to find most of the life portraits of Thomas Paine. There are a few that are missing, but I did assemble some of them. And then we put those together, and my brother looked at them, he scanned them, he played with them in the computer, overlaid them somewhat, and then tried to come up with what he thought was a realistic picture of what he might have looked like.
You mentioned to me off camera something about the Paine death mask,
Oh, yes.
something you looked into. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, my brother mentioned that, you know, if there was anything physical of his, like a death mask, that would be helpful. And it turns out that John Wesley Jarvis did do a death mask of Paine 4 hours after he died, and that survives. They have it at the Thomas Paine Historical Society in New Rochelle, New York. And so I did get a photograph of it, and then he utilized that. And he said that was a very important piece because it gave the bone structure and some of the other clues to what he might have looked like.
You have some other pictures that I
Yes.
think you're going to explain for us.
Yes, I thought I'd show you a few of the pictures, a few of the most well-known portraits of Thomas Paine, and then and show you a little bit of how those were used, and then progress into the poster that we're going to do. So probably the most well-known of the portraits of Thomas Paine is the Romney. George Romney painted a portrait of Thomas Paine before The Rights of Man was published, and before or it was about the time The Rights of Man, it was before the Age of Reason, which was the one that you were asking about before. And that portrait is on the cover of a recent book about Paine, and this is the portrait here, and it is hanging in the Thomas Paine Historical Society in New Rochelle, New York.
Is that you or your brother who?
That's me.
That's you. I just wondered if your brother was a lookalike. I
No.
didn't know if you were twins or not.
No, we're not twins. He's 2 years younger and looks completely different. It's like a Nordic what, a Viking a little bit,
I hope he'll find out that you called him that on this program.
Yes. He'll see this, I'm sure. And so the George Romney is probably, most people consider it the best portrait of Paine. It is one the Paine Society would like to use as the main image of Thomas Paine. The next portrait I have here is by John Trimble, and this was a portrait that was commissioned by Thomas Jefferson. It is there were it's a matched set of one of Thomas Paine and one of Thomas Jefferson. And this particular one hangs right now in Monticello. I went and saw it. It's in the, I guess you call it the living room. It's the room with the sort of circular windows that face out to the garden and the backyard. So it's hanging there today. I saw it, checked it out. At any rate, that one was found in a trunk somewhere in New England with its eyes gouged out, and it was restored, and now they have it at Monticello.
One addendum for those who don't know, Monticello is the Thomas Jefferson estate.
Yes, the Thomas Jefferson estate in Virginia. I think it's Charlottesville in Virginia. And the next painting that I have is the Jarvis painting. Now, this is done when Thomas Paine was much older. This is when he'd come back from France after he got out of prison and in France and was back here. And Jarvis did this very nice portrait. They were great friends. And so this is the portrait that was used for the postage stamp, the 40-cent postage stamp that came out. And this is the only stamp that I know of, at least in the United States, that was done of Thomas Paine. I understand there was a stamp done in another country, but this is the only one we know of Paine.
John, can you tell us why Paine was in prison in France?
Yes, he was when he was in France, he was in France during the French Revolution. And of course, when he got to France, he was a big hero after having written The Rights of Man. And they put him on the National Assembly, and he was very well hailed. Everyone loved his writings. And when they took the king and decided they were going to kill him, he spoke up for the king. He said, "You've killed the kingdom, why kill the man?" Anybody growing up in this situation would have done the same thing. And so he argued for humanity. He said, "If you want to show the world this is a humane revolution, this is your chance." And of course they didn't listen to him. They tried to drown him out. First they said he's being misinterpreted, but then they said, "No, the interpretation is correct," and all these other things, because the radicals really wanted to kill the king. And so, of course, then after that, Paine was suspected, and Robespierre had him imprisoned. And there he languished for quite a while.
That's quite a story in and of itself, I'm sure.
Yes. Thomas Paine had an extremely interesting life. I'm surprised they haven't done a movie of him yet.
Well, with all the work you're doing here on Paine, maybe you're the guy to come up with this script.
Well, I'm not a script writer, but one thing we did notice in doing this portrait for the poster is that he looked somewhat like Michael Douglas.
There you go. We're here. This show is going out all over the country, but our originating home is Long Beach, California. We're within the shadow of Hollywood, so to anyone out there, any agents, anyone, especially Michael Douglas, if you hear about this, This is a ripe role for you, and you know he's probably about the age now where he could play Paine, don't you think?
I think so.
And maybe with a little age makeup still.
He's got the temperament. He's got the, I think he's got the looks. He's got the temperament, and he could do it. I think he'd make a great Paine. And so I think that people really loved him, especially in France at the beginning of the French Revolution. And one of the portraits I didn't mention is by David. David had done all of the other members of the National Assembly during the Revolution. And of course, he was probably the best painter of all at that time. And they know that he painted a Paine. He was a big admirer of Thomas Paine. They just haven't been able to find it. And we hope that they do find it at some point, because I'm sure it'll be good. But in the meantime, in France, they did make a Bacharach crystal of Thomas Paine. Now, this was based a little bit on the Sharp portrait that was done resulting from the Romney portrait. But this Bacharach crystal that we have right here is from France. There are two of them. There's this one, and there's also a green one. It's a little bit thicker. Probably one of the nicest looking things I've seen yet that's been made of Thomas Paine.
It's a beautiful piece.
Yes. Beautiful paperweight, and I've got the other one as well. Just didn't have the case for it, so I don't want to bring it here today. But at any rate, we hope someday we'll run across the David portrait, but in the meantime, we thought we'll make our own portrait. So when we went back to the museum and said we're working on this portrait of Paine, and they had another request from us. They said, "Look, we need another poster. Would you please make this poster for us? Because this organization, the museum, is supposed to be promoting the freedom of the press, and we wanted the First Amendment. And would you please do a First Amendment poster for us?" Now they'd already done part of the idea and the artwork. They had something similar already. So we just went ahead and made one for them, and that's the First Amendment poster that you've seen here. And they now sell this in the bookstore. Apparently they've put it on their website, and so they're starting to get a lot more orders for it.